welcome to the Every Movie Ever podcast. My name is Ben Groves.
And my name is Rob McFarlane. Welcome to the show, a movie podcast slash mental health check-in for two broken brain best friends talking around their problems, but not about their problems, whilst laughing at movies. But given that this is a thinly veiled mental health check-in, Ben, before I get to what we're doing, how are you doing, buddy? Choking to death.
I'm ill.
Yeah.
I don't think I'm ill.
Okay.
I might be ill.
You're just malnourished.
I'm just really tired.
You're just living on a diet of pure creatine.
I just need creatine, Lucozade, and protein yogurts. I just need a cuddle. I need a cuddle.
Are you on the pomegranate and blueberry yogurts?
Yeah.
From Lidl?
Yeah, they're delicious,
aren't they?
They're Aldi.
Oh, yeah.
Incredible. How are you, buddy?
Similarly, we get different migraines. You get like a headache with visual disturbances and this. I get like, I can't move and I vomit and like lights cause me to cry. So
you get the pussy ones. I get the really manly Sigma ones. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Fight Club. You get the Fight Club ones. That's what you get.
I get the Fight Club ones. You get the Magnolia ones. Yeah. That's where we're at.
So I was in bed for 2 days and I couldn't turn up to work. And then I basically haven't been able to do the pod. I haven't been able to do socials. Haven't been able to do my job. And the entire week is ruined because I missed 2 days. On the theme of being ruined.
Yes.
What are we doing this week, Ben?
Oh, that's a horrible transition. Going to be challenging that one very, very shortly. Come on, get up, get happy. We're doing Joker, Folie A Deux.
Yeah. And the error of the second. That's what that means, doesn't it?
Oh, no, it means fun of the two, Rob. Be more cultured.
Right, okay.
The brand spanking new sequel to Todd Phillips' 2019 billion-dollar hit, Joker.
Yes, and given that this is about a film that's new out, we are assuming that you are coming to us having seen the film.
I'm not.
This is a post-cinema, or you've heard it's bad and you want to know why it's bad without spending 20 quid plus at the cinema.
Yes, that's exactly what people are doing, because I've seen the numbers, mate. No one's seen it.
Right. Right, okay. So this is a spoiler-ridden episode,
yes.
And we've got a lot to get through. We're going to get into what is going on with Joker 2, why all the hate.
Does this film punish fans of Joker 1?
Does this film punish everyone?
Sometimes. Is this film intentionally bad?
And most importantly, is this the true Joker's origin story?
Ooh, that sounds like Ben's got a theory.
Ben has got a theory, and I've not heard it yet, and I'm terrified.
You should be. So this was released in 2024 to a flock of hate.
Is that the 80s band?
Yes.
With the long haircuts, flock of hate.
And I ran from Folie A Deux. Followed you.
This was an absolute box office bomb.
It's
Ben.
Dreadful, mate.
This is the worst rated superhero movie ever. You know Madame Web?
Yes.
Got a cinema score.
C plus. Yeah.
This got D.
D. D for dick in good time. Do you know what I mean?
They spent 200 mil on this film.
Yep. And then an extra 100 mil on marketing. Mate, the expenditures of the cast, the film, the marketing, to break even on this film, they have to make 450 million. That's to break even. They have to make that.
They're not going to, are they?
What, do you want to know what it did make?
Well, it's been out a week.
Yeah?
I reckon at least, I'm going to, realistically, for my expectations, if I hadn't known, if I hadn't seen the film, and if I hadn't seen the reaction, mm-hmm. I would have expected this to have already made somewhere in the region of 150 mil.
Okay. Well, that... All right. Well, that was a mad voice crack. Well,
well, that. There's my Fight Club Sigma boy.
Nailed it. Look at my fucking bicep, mate.
One.
Oh,
swear jar. Five swears, they get to send pictures of our phobias, be they owls or crabs, to any of our social media platforms.
Yeah.
We've got four left, mate.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine. Well, stick around to the end of the episode. We're going to be getting into the figures and how much it's made in its first week. We understand that if you're listening to this in the future, however many years down the line, this next part will be meaningless, but please still stick around to the end because, you know...
Why not? It's going to be... We got a lot of fun. We got a lot of fun. Now, this is a huge deal at the moment.
Yeah.
This was one of the most successful films of recent years. This is one of the most watched films on letterboxd.com as of recording, with millions and millions of users logging that their love for the original film.
Mm-hmm.
And we wanted to take a look at the sequel that no one wanted. Because no one went, oh, wow, I can't wait to see where that story goes. Everyone went, that was plenty, thank you.
See,
that was everything I wanted, tied up in a bow. Lovely. What a lovely little standalone story.
I'm in a different camp to those people because I saw that and was like, yeah, but realistically, what would happen after? And you know what, mate?
Fuck all.
I'm going to get
exactly.
That's two, Rob. Two. I hate this swear jar.
Well, that's the film we got. We got a film documenting exactly that. Now, I have to address the elephant in the room, Ben.
Yep. Come on.
Joker 2 is a musical, and a lot of our Discord users and regular listeners have been demanding.
They have.
That this episode also be a musical.
They have. I think it should be. I think we should do every point to in the form of a 1930s rap. And I'm thinking maybe we turn it into some sort of
1930s rap.
Yep. I'm thinking.
Is that like 1800s techno?
Yes. It's okay. It's just washboards and thimbles.
Okay.
Yeah, that's my favorite band. So what I'm thinking that we do is we turn it into some sort of rap battle.
We've done rap, mate. We completed it. Big tick.
Yeah. But this
what,
is rap
what
battle.
I've done. So no, what is... I've done. What okay. I've done. I've got this covered because we can't do the whole episode. It would be, like the film, incredibly grating and cut the pacing of the film down to a crawl. So if we just concentrate it into the breakdown.
Just the breakdown. Nothing else.
Just the breakdown.
Fine. All right, I'm in.
I'll play the jingle.
All right.
And we'll see where we are after that, shall we?
All right, yeah, let's go. Let's go. We're having a breakdown. All right, so this is what we're doing then, yeah?
Yep.
All right, Sam.
Well, I mean, we said in the episode we would, and we pre-recorded it, so...
That line, Arthur's stuck in Arkham now.
I'm so stuck now.
Waiting for a trial.
Tick tock.
Feeling low somehow.
Oh,
boo-hoo. Buddy meets a girl.
Oh, hello.
Named Lee.
Hello, Lee.
And she's got a twisted past.
Really?
Just like me.
Oh, samesies.
That's life. In a courtroom, things get tough.
Touch.
With a story that feels disjointed and rough.
Yes, it do.
But he won't let it bring him down.
Just everyone else.
As chaos reigns in Gotham Town. I've been a patient, a prisoner, a killer, a clown. A pawn and a king. I've been up and down, lost in this town, but I know one thing. Each time I find myself caught up in the chase, I fight my way back and face what I've embraced. That's life. He thought he'd win, but critics reign. With pacing flaws.
Oh, that's me.
And a story that's plain.
Shit, this is just brilliant now.
But he won't let it bring him down.
He shouldn't.
Cause the Joker's laugh will echo around. I've been so patient to say this, to give you the basics, but this film got me good. Through ups and downs with our favorite clown. And I understood each time he found himself punched right in the face. I saw my past self put right in his place. That's Ben.
Not Rob.
This film was all his darkest fears.
It fucking was, buddy.
In a film that left Rob unable to cheer. But we won't let it bring us down. Cause we got musical.
We got musical.
For our breakdown.
For our fucking breakdown.
Why did we do this?
We might be smooth-brained.
Oh, that was fun. A lot, Ben.
That was fun. That was exactly really? What I needed to be. Yeah,
that's terrifying. That was terrifying. I can't believe we're putting that out.
It's on the internet, mate. It's out there forever. If we ever get cancelled, that will live on in for forever. You know what I mean? When we're 90, when you're on your deathbed and you're like, Ben, was I a good boy? I'll be like, yeah. And then I'm just going to play that on repeat.
That's what I say on my deathbed. Was I a good boy?
I don't know. I kind of look at me and you as like, you're my best pet dog, second to Roxy, and I'm your best pet dog ever.
I thoroughly dislike... Firstly, that's some shocking Lola erasure. My dog Lola would be...
No, Lola's great. Lola's incredible. But I'm just saying that if me and Lola were to fight, I wouldn't fight Lola. She's too... Yeah, you're right. Exactly. You're right. I'm second to Lola. Of course I am.
Right. I've got a question for you, Ben.
Go on.
Why all the hate for this film? I can tell you at length, but what do you think?
Right. Okay. So people are up in arms right now.
Right.
Yeah. The reviews are shocking. It is receiving a tsunami of hate. I cannot for the life of me understand where it's all coming from because...
Can you not?
No, I genuinely, right? I read all the... Before seeing the film, I read all the reviews. Mm-hmm. I was like, oh God, it's horrible. It's horrible. I went into the cinema with my expectations on the floor, yeah?
Right.
And I know for a fact that I've seen this film more than most people who are fucking raving about it, right?
Right, yeah.
Because I've seen the box office figures, Rob. No one's seen this.
Yeah. They'd look. I've seen this twice. No, yeah.
They'd look so much different if people were watching this film. It would look a lot different. I went in with my expectations on the floor, and I came out pleasantly surprised because I was like, it never got as bad as I was mm-hmm. expecting it to, based on what I was reading, and that was a positive for me. I was like, oh, okay, pleasantly surprised.
Well, let me just quickly read a review that I found on Google.
Go on.
From a Joker fan who perhaps came to the film a little bit more literally.
Hit me.
This was a 0.5 out of 100 star rating movie. Complete waste of time. The director doesn't even understand his own movie. He neutered the Joker in his second movie because Todd Phillips is an elite.
What?
He then goes on to talk about Joker 1. It does well because everyone can relate to the average guy finally not putting up with BS from the elites.
Oh.
Right?
Shut up.
As for this second film, it was bad. Every time Gaga opens her mouth, the movie goes downhill, and I like Gaga and her works, but she's literally the cue for when the movie starts to go downhill every other scene.
Shut up.
They made Joker look dumb as fuck and so weak, i.e. Joker randomly bangs Gaga for like 5 seconds and then comes. Weak and shameful to the character. Now, here's my favourite bit, and I'll end it here.
Oh my God.
In a true Batman Joker setting film, there's no random sex scenes. Second off, Joker is a stud. He doesn't need sex.
Shut up. This is written by a person who has held two doors open today and not gotten one hand job, and he is furious about it.
I love the idea that he watched Joker 1 and he was like... That guy's a stud.
Oh my God, that's actually made my skin crawl. What are you talking about? Right, this is my main point here, Rob. Right. This is my main point. I think this film's doing terrible because this is a brutal punishment of Joker.
Right.
And to an extent, his fandom are taking it personally, right?
Uh-huh.
And as we discussed in our Joker episode, famously misinterpreted by very, very many people. Yeah?
I agree.
Thank you. I think fans of the Joker, far and wide, are left with bitter tastes in their mouths, right?
Uh-huh.
Folie A Deux has left some weird residue, some weird French undertones to their favorite character, and they don't like it. I mean, even Rolling Stone called it a fuck you to the fans, and it's like, I don't understand where this is coming from, because it's the fans of Joker that are up in arms about it misinterpreted Joker. So now we're catering to mental people that are like, excuse me, I went to a swimming bath and didn't get one hand job. I am a stud.
Okay.
All right.
Just slam the brakes for a second there, right? Because I think lots of people have said that this movie is punishing the fans. Punishing the fans that had mistaken Joker as an idol, right?
Right, okay. I've heard this too.
I've got no problem with it doing that. Mm. I think that's a very correct thing to do.
Yeah.
But I think it's a little more nuanced than that.
Okay.
It's asking you to remember that Joker isn't a superhero, right? This isn't Mark Hamill's Joker or Jack Nicholson's Joker.
No.
This is Arthur Fleck, he's not the Messiah. He's a very, very unwell boy. Right?
Yes. He's a very right? unwell man.
I think the first film and the sequel both try and make the point that you might love the idea of pain making you strong. And I think a lot of people misinterpreted that first film as he goes through all that pain and it makes him strong and he becomes a victimizer. He decides he's, and that's a thing to be celebrated. This is the thing.
It is not though.
It's nice to imagine a world where pain makes you strong, but it doesn't. What makes you strong is the work you do after the pain.
Yes.
Right? Pain would be a good thing. Right?
Exactly.
Pain gives you nothing, and hurting people teaches them nothing worthwhile.
Exactly.
And so Arthur Fleck is not some genius. He's a man who's been hurt again and again and again. He's got no healthy support network. And then Harley and Gotham fall in love with a vengeful victim who's doomed to die.
Yes.
Not a lonely man who has a future.
Exactly.
Right.
But this is the thing.
All of that is great.
Yeah.
All of that is great. It's just executed terribly. And I think it'd be a shame to wrap up the negative fan reaction to the people who misinterpreted the film and go, oh, Joker's not a stud in this one. Obviously, they're mentals. And Todd Phillips is correct to try and make a film that punishes those fans. I would be well up for it.
I think that is what happened,
It's just
though.
The film... It's a dog shit film, Ben. Three.
But this is the thing.
It's awful.
So,
and it's not because of anything that happens in the film. It's the execution. It's the pacing.
Right.
It's everything about that. It's not a good film to do that with. And it's not because of the tone or the intent or this, that, or the other. It's everything else.
I hear you wholeheartedly, right? I hear you. I understand you. I can see exactly where you're coming from.
I think to relate the fanboy reaction
and the
critical reaction together is a flaw. The fanboys are annoyed for stupid
different
reasons. Fair enough.
Yeah.
And
the critics
are
annoyed because of the filmmaking choices, which is fine. And they're both fine. They're both correct. And if that's how you feel about this film, you are correct. There is no wrong or right choices here. I'm going to have to disagree personally, though.
Okay.
I think this film went down a road that I didn't necessarily want to follow, but I had to, right?
Right.
It's a gritty, grueling, it's hard to watch in places, so sometimes for the right reason, sometimes for the wrong.
Right.
I enjoy both of those reasons.
Uh-huh.
It's a portrayal of an accidental idol, Arthur Fleck, and how he was thrown into fame that he didn't ask for and he didn't deserve.
Right.
And it's the culmination of his crimes catching up to him, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, we see in Joker 2 that the system has failed him time and time again.
Yes.
Now the justice system is failing him.
Yeah.
The correctional services are failing him because Brendan Gleeson appears to be all sort of like cheeky boy, like, hey, he's evil as anything. And he is sinister as anything in this film. It's incredible. I love that aspect.
Brendan Gleeson's performance in this is faultless. It always
is.
It's Brendan
Gleeson. Flawless.
The man can do no professional wrong.
He literally can do no professional wrong. It's incredible.
Right.
The thing that I love about this film more than anything is we're inside Arthur's head. Arthur is fully in the driving seat in this one, right?
Yes.
And I feel like with the musical aspect and stuff like this, what you've just said, pain doesn't make you strong. It's what you do after that makes you strong, right? I will 1,000% agree with you because it's how you process it, how you learn from your mistakes, and how you better yourself going forward. That's the most important thing
you
here.
You and I both know people who something bad happens to them and they just sit there in
exactly.
it and go, well, that's me done.
Us 10 years ago, mate.
Yeah, exactly.
With crippling cocaine habits.
Right. Like, why aren't you moving on with your life? Because a bad thing happened.
Exactly. And it's
like, cool. Well, no one's coming to pick you up. What are you going to do about it?
Yeah.
I can't.
And it's fine to be there for a bit. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
Everyone is there at some point in the
for
time.
A bit.
And that's fine. But it's getting up and dusting yourself off. Arthur Fleck does not do that.
Yeah.
Arthur Fleck lashes out.
No.
He doesn't look inward. He lashes out and he takes it out on the world. And
It must be everyone else that's wrong.
Everyone else is wrong. The finger is always pointed outwards. It's never like held up to a mirror. Now, the musical aspect of this film.
Yes.
Is when we see Arthur is in a stressful situation. It's a very dramatic moment, and the dramatic moment seems to be undermined by a musical number, right? And for the first once or twice that this happened, I was like, oh, mm-hmm. it kind of, you know, it takes away the seriousness. It sort of, you know, deviates away from the seriousness of the drama mm-hmm. that's happening around him. And there is one moment in this film where there is a very intense dramatic moment with
right.
no musical number coming in. And mm-hmm. it is the moment when Arthur cannot escape that moment right there. He has to be present. He has to be
yes.
focal to that point mm-hmm. happening. And that hit me like a ton of bricks without the music. Because right. I'd gotten so used to going, you know, it's just going to deviate away from mm-hmm. it. And then when it didn't, I was like, okay. And in my mind, something clicked and I was like, the musicals and the musical numbers is Arthur drifting into a little fantasy world.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. To not be present in these horrible moments that he now has to deal with because he's on trial for of five course. Murders with the
I get that.
The guilt of a sixth on his mind. And I'm like, oh my God, I love this stuff.
I found that the music
yeah.
in a musical usually performs the task of expressing. And I get that this was trying to be a subversion before you button, right?
No, it's fine. Go on.
What Todd Phillips was trying to subvert was the musical language where the song and the fantastical performance that you see mm-hmm. is a depiction of the emotional state of the character.
Yes. Gorgeous.
Except it doesn't happen in this film because
yeah.
Arthur Fleck and Harley Quinn both sing in their characters' untrained voices.
Yeah.
So we've kept the reality of the situation
yep.
in their flight of fantasy.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So we now have an unpleasant to listen to vocal.
Yeah.
Over a song that very rarely relates to the narrative in a way that's emotionally connecting.
Yes.
I'd say the only time that the song choice emotionally connects with what's happening
yeah.
is when Arthur sings the If You Go Away Jacques Brel song
yeah.
to Harley down the phone.
Yeah.
Every other time what happened is in a film that's already slow,
yep.
a film in which the character already has no agency whatsoever,
yep.
makes no choices for himself,
yep.
is purely reactive the entire yep. time, and in a film with arguably three locations,
yes.
we're then stopping that absolute smorgasbord of nothing happening
yep.
to have even less happen
okay.
in a flight of fantasy...
Yep.
Where no one sings with fantasy voices
yep.
and no incredible staging happens. So you have this sort of funeral march
yep.
of dull, interrupted with dull.
Yes.
And I am aware that it's...
Okay.
It's gritty and it's subversive.
No.
But it's not engaging.
Again, I'll agree with you.
You can be as thematically right as you like.
I agree.
But I'm not gripped.
That's fine. I was very gripped by this. I like the fact that it's not great voices. I like the fact that they keep their reality voices because it's almost like a commentary on Arthur on how
not
he
being able to imagine himself as more capable than
as
he
being
is.
Anything like, yeah. more than what he already is. And that is
yes.
the most heartbreaking thing. And when you really sit and think about it, that didn't hit me at first. Do you want to know when it did hit me?
Right.
In the credits, right. I was in tears, right? I don't know if you stuck around for the credits, but there is it rolls for a bit and then it goes dead silent and it's Joaquin Phoenix covering Daniel Johnston's True Love Will Find You in the End.
And, oh, okay. I didn't stick around. I wanted to go leave as quickly as possible so yeah. I could watch my own urine flow down the toilet because it would be more engaging.
That's fine. I stuck around for some credits. He did Daniel Johnston, True Love Will Find You in the End, and it was the most gorgeous
okay, that does sound pretty good.
moment in a cinema ever. Me and my friend Amber were sitting there, we were chatting mm-hmm. about the film, and I was like, was it as bad as you thought it was going to be? She was like, no, I've read so many reviews that were like, this
right.
is the worst film in existence ever.
It's not.
It's not.
I also left the cinema going, that wasn't as bad
yeah.
as everyone says it is.
I know, but the thing with
it's
Daniel Johnston cover
needless.
Is it's not his bad singing voice. It's his
right.
gorgeous singing yeah. voice on one of the most...
Because he did Walk the Line with as yes. Johnny Cash and he nailed it.
Yes, but this is one of the most cripplingly beautiful songs that exists. And for anyone that knows me, knows that my relationship mm-hmm. with Daniel Johnston is that...
Toxic AF.
I love that man beyond belief, right?
I
listen to him daily. I'm full on obsessed. That one song, when I saw him live, he played it. I was in bits for about a week and a half after. I couldn't fully function. And then to hear it at the end of this film, I was like, oh my God. Oh my God. And then it started hitting me bit by bit.
Do you think Todd Phillips legitimately made this to try and dissuade the wrong type of fan from liking his film?
I've got the answer. And I know it's the answer because it's from Todd Phillips, right? This is from an interview that Todd Phillips did with IGN. IGN asked Todd Phillips, is this a response to toxic fandom? Mm-hmm. Bear with me because it's a little bit long, but it nails it on the head and it's essentially like a done point after this, all right?
Okay, nice, right.
So Phillips said, not so much that, to be honest with you, but one of the things that we always thought about the first movie, or one of the things I definitely said enough in defending the first movie when it needed to be defended, because people said it was irresponsible in its use of violence, and I always saw it quite literally the opposite.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was responsible because it was showing the actual real-world effects of violence.
Right.
It wasn't glamorizing gun use in my mind.
Mm-hmm.
It was actually showing, oh my God, this is brutal.
Yes.
And I think the reality of it maybe is what turned people off, with the people that were turned off.
Right.
One of the things we tried to continue with here is to me, a really important scene in the movie is when he's cross-examining the little guy, Gary. Why?
Mm-hmm.
Because it's been showing you the real-world effects of a trauma on a person who witnessed it, right?
That is a great scene. Best scene in the film.
It is heartbreaking. Even beyond just witnessing something horrible, what does that do to you, right? You know what mm-hmm. I mean? It's 2 or 3 years later in the movie and Gary still says he can't sleep and he still wasn't able to go back to work. These effects of violence was something we really wanted to kind of, at least that scene, address some part of.
Yes.
But not so much toxic fandom, honestly, but that is a good idea. And the interview goes on with mm-hmm. Todd Phillips and Joaquin Phoenix. And Joaquin Phoenix says, I don't like it when filmmakers set out with a point to make. When
right.
they guide your opinion of a film by saying this is categorically what this film is saying. He loves it when you can gather information from a film and you interpret it in
exactly
your own way.
What Joker 1 was.
Yes.
It was a smorgasbord of stuff that you could draw what you wanted from.
Yeah, and I think this one is a broader spectrum on a smaller stage.
Yeah.
The smaller stage is the fallout from the first film. What happens to an infamous serial killer who is now an accidental icon for all of the disenfranchised people in a city ravished with poverty.
Yeah.
And it's a courtroom drama at the end of the day.
Yeah.
It's a courtroom drama and a musical. It's not my film. It shouldn't be my film.
No, but weirdly it is. And yeah. I, this is everything I hate about the kind of films that I'm often accused of liking, because it's dull. And I think
yes.
One of the big problems I have with it is that Joker 1 exists in its own right.
Yeah, it does.
It sets out its own story,
yep.
and it doesn't explain itself, and it doesn't have a point to make
yeah.
more than this is the story we're telling, and it is controversial, and you can look at it in lots of different ways.
Yep.
You can sit there and go, oh yeah, what a stud, he stood up against, you know, authority, and now everything's better. You can look at him as a victim,
yeah.
all this kind of stuff. But it exists in its own universe.
It does. It does.
This film is almost exclusively a conversation with the first film. It's almost okay. exclusively an overthought reaction to what the first film was. And it at no point goes, what is this film saying about itself?
Okay.
We're going to have it be a musical, but we're going to controvert the musical. We're going to have it be about the Joker, but actually we're going to have him go back on the thing that he said in the last film. We're going to have him presented this way because of how he was presented in the last film. Mm-hmm. It's an entirely reactionary work that's so overthought Ooh. In so many ways. It doesn't exist in itself. It has none of its own merits. It only works as a conversational reply to the first film.
Okay.
And I do genuinely believe, like, Todd Phillips didn't do any test screenings.
He
refused to meet with the studio.
Yeah.
He did this completely by himself because he's the great genius who did the first one, right?
I don't think that's the reasoning behind it, but
it smells
you
a little bit.
You interpreted it way different to me, but yeah,
right.
I'll agree. That's
and
fine.
I don't think the more I read of Todd Phillips in interview, I don't think he was intentionally creating the work of genius that we saw with Joker 1. I think it was one of those things where lots of things came together.
Yeah.
And it came out and it resonated. And I do sympathize with that.
It's almost like Joker was just thrown into infamy without really asking for it or deserving right. it.
But then when they say do a sequel, well, nothing is gonna happen.
Of course.
To this character that is even slightly as interesting mm-hmm. as the first film.
Oh yeah, 1000%, 1000%.
We're just gonna have it be him go, actually, I'm not Joker. And have it be
Hold
what
on.
Happens.
You cannot play that down to that degree that much.
No, I can because what it does is it robs drama from the first film.
Okay, kind
because,
of.
Because rather than this being the moment that a man decides, that's it, I've gone too far, I'm in the wilds now, and do you know what? That's life. I'm going to get my kicks stomping on a dream.
Yeah.
The second film, what are you going to do that's as interesting, Todd? What if he went, ooh, actually, I'm not.
Okay, I have something for this because you've just underplayed the most important part aspect of this film for me. The bit that sang to me the most in this film is when he's in court. This film is ruined, by the way. It's spoiled. It's everywhere. The spoiler warning is everywhere, right? This is your biggest spoiler warning because from here on out, mm-hmm. we have to talk about aspects that are in the film that we cannot avoid because you've just ruined my entire takeaway and I shan't be disrespected this way, sir.
Well, but before you do, I just want to say, I feel like with the first film, Todd Phillips had an incredible map because he wanted to make a Scorsese-style character study. Yeah. And he had the best map in the world. He had King of Comedy with Robert De Niro, which just needed to be changed in pace, updated, and had a superhero mask put on it. And that's exactly what he delivered, but he did it with a great twist and a great freshening up of the formula.
Yeah. No, I hear what you're saying.
And then he just went in with no map this time around.
I disagree, but continue.
And didn't have a Scorsese. There's no sequel to King of Comedy for him to go,
not.
Oh, that's good for me to lift. He's a man that works well with limitations for me.
Okay, that's fine.
And I used to work with artists all the time, and they'd be like, do that thing again. Mm-hmm. And you've got no idea how you did it. It was a million and one things coming together magically.
Of course. Yeah.
And I don't think he had any idea what a Joker sequel needed to be.
Okay.
And still be engaging. I just don't, because it's not an engaging film.
That's fine. The scene that you have just destroyed in front of my very face was my favorite part of this film by a long shot. It is it's a deluded, mentally ill man who is being manipulated into thinking that he has found love for the first time in his life. He's found a true supporter, someone that gets him, someone that understands mm-hmm. him, someone that is there for him.
Yes.
And someone that will be there until the end.
Yes.
She's in love with him. She says that she's pregnant with his baby. Obviously.
Right.
He's not a stud. He's not out plowing every weekend. This is a big thing for him.
And yes.
Once he's found this, the delusion doesn't seem as appealing because of what he has in real life is much more appealing.
Yeah, he finally has an alternative. He's got something to live for.
Exactly.
He's got something to lose.
And then when he's in this courtroom, the prosecutor, Harvey Dent, incredible actor, by the way. I don't know his name off the top of my head. Incredible part.
Really? For me, the only interesting thing about that character was the fact he was called Harvey Dent.
No, he's a buttoned down nerdy lawyer. It's perfect. I think he played it perfect.
Yeah, it's the standard smarmy DA that we've seen in every film.
That's the sort of person that I want to see go Two-Face. That's the Two-Face that I want to see go weird. You know what I mean? Because he's that type of guy has got some stuff in his closet. I want to see it.
He's every single courtroom drama antagonist you've ever seen before.
Yes.
With nothing interesting.
But this is the thing. What if those guys got blown up by a bomb, lost half their face, and then went weird? That's what I want to see.
You love this bit of the film.
So I love this bit of the film, right? And it's him, and he's cross-examining Gary. He's presented with the woman that he was stalking and, you mm-hmm. know, very much upsetting. And these witnesses and these victims to his sort of his Joker antics from the first film.
Yeah.
And the realization of all of the effect that he's had on these innocent people's lives. Mm-hmm. Gary was one of his friends. He was supporting him. He was like, you know, go get him,
Great
Gary.
Scene.
Go get him, Gary. He's sitting there in front of the jury, and it slaps him square in the face.
Right.
That the people who are his fans and they're cheering him on, they're not cheering on Arthur Fleck. They're cheering on
Joker.
No,
they're cheering on the idea of...
the delusion.
Screw all of you, we're going to burn it to the ground.
It's Arthur Fleck not being Arthur Fleck. He's not being accepted for him. But whereas what he feels with Lee, mm-hmm. Harley Quinn, he feels like he's being accepted for him.
Yeah.
And it washes over him that all of a sudden, Joker is a fantasy. These are my crimes. I need to face the facts of what has happened. There were 6 murders. I killed my mother.
Mm-hmm.
This is where we're at. Right? And there is...
Yes.
The musical numbers after that are so painful that it's like, oh my God. Yeah. It's pure introspective moment. And coming from a mentally unwell man, I've done some soul searching, right? I've been holding the mirror up pretty close to my face the last couple years. And yeah. it's not pretty.
But once there's not a straw between you and the mirror.
Exactly. You know what I mean? Now it's not lightly covered in powder. It's like I can really get a good look at it. It's horrible. I hate doing it because it makes me feel sad. It makes me feel scared. It makes me feel somewhat alone. Mm. I'm just fortunate enough that I have you. I have my friends. Yep. I have my family.
And you've not done 5 murders.
And I've not done 5 murders. Do you know what I mean? Like I'm in a much luckier position. And it just made me really... really appreciate everything all in
one
go. Okay,
brilliant.
And it was
brilliant.
A gobsmacking moment. And I understand from a filmmaking point of view, it's a very boring film. It's very boring. The pacing's horrible.
It is, because imagine sitting down to James Cameron's Aliens, right?
Yeah.
And it's a courtroom drama with Ripley being on trial
for the
destruction of the Nostromo.
Yeah.
And the big narrative arc of the film is her going... Actually, I don't think there was an alien.
Right. Yeah, I agree. That would be horrible.
And instead of aliens, we've got...
But there's nothing there for me. But when it's a mentally ill dude who's like having a breakthrough and being sort of like, oh my God, I'm like,
right,
buddy! I keep reading this stuff. Coming back to the musicals real quick. There's so many people complaining about it. And they're like, Joker doesn't sing and dance. It's like, watch.
Yes, he does.
Watch
yes,
it all the time.
Yes, he absolutely does.
All the time. Shut up. He's a clown.
Have you ever seen a Batman animated series?
Dude, watch the animated stuff.
Wait.
Sings and dances all the time. What are you talking about? What's wrong with you?
What are you talking about? Look, I think I've got no problem with the direction of the movie. I've just got a problem with the... There is nothing in there that is as interesting enough to warrant a film.
That's fine.
About this character. It's like, okay, like you said, wow, what happens to that character after Joker 1?
Yeah.
And the answer is, well, he sort of mooches about in prison for a bit, has horrible stuff done to him, gets led on, has a pretty dull court case, and then dies.
I love how you sum this up. We'd sum this up so different. I'd be like, struggles to understand any relationship that people are presenting to him because it's all false. All of it is false.
Of course. I get...
That's terrifying to me. I think it's my trust issues. It's my past traumas coming through.
Uh-huh.
Watching a guy who can't deal with that stuff suddenly go,
great,
I need to. And that was it. That was it for me. That's the takeaway. That's me done. Filmmaking, horrible. Pacing, horrible. But it's a fun thought experiment after you watch a film and you go, yeah, but I mean, okay, so take like Heath Ledger's Joker.
Mm-hmm.
When he blows out the bank with a school bus and then just drives
Incredible.
Away. I like to sit and think sometimes and go, but what happened to the bank tellers when they were like, now we've got to fix a hole in the wall?
No. The thing that I always get this with, right, because I'm watching a lot of fantasy stuff at the moment. Rings of Power's been on.
Yeah.
Why? And it's expensive. It's expensive fan fiction, and I'm like, oh, it's pretty.
Yeah. Okay, fair.
It's brain rot, but it's pretty brain rot.
Okay.
There's lots of scenes where like leaders raise their swords in the air, and everyone has a big shout. They're like, yeah.
Oh God.
And then it cuts, and I'm like, how long did they do that for? And then when you stop,
right?
What do you do next? Right, you just go, that's my favourite bit. It's brilliant, that is.
Oh,
when he raises his sword and there's a shout.
Mate, you did a great shout, that one. That was what? That was way longer than last week's.
And then what do you do? Like, you just go back to mooching about.
You just go, well, I've got to hit the safe way before it shuts because...
That's got to be the most awkward experience in the world.
Yes.
When you're in a big group of people and you all do a big team cheer and then like...
Rob, I would see that film in the cinema twice. I would see the immediate... If a film started with the tail right. end of a leader sword in the air and everyone just immediately going, yeah! So do we go now or is this like a hype up thing? Like, right, is this like, the meeting? Is this the preamble?
Right.
Because I've got food on. I need to do something before we leave. I didn't realize we were leaving right now.
It's the sort of thing that makes sense before a battle scene. But if you do it any other time, they always do it when they're like, oh, we're all a bit downtrodden because we're retreating. And then they do the sword moment and everyone's better. And I'm like, but you've still got laundry to do.
Yeah.
Post shouty bit.
Yeah. Have you told everyone that you're leaving immediately? Hey, right. What's your family
this
thinking?
This film is that, and you're right, it is a lovely thought experiment.
Yes, that's all it is.
It's not a $450 million movie.
No, it is not. Right? I can't even defend it that much, man. Right? I went in and I had a fun time because I was expecting absolute blended horse juice.
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
This would have been a brilliant graphic novel.
Oh, so good. Yeah, I agree.
It would have been a brilliant graphic novel.
Yeah.
And I knew that we were in trouble the moment the film started because it starts with an animated sequence. And I was like, oh, wow, this is going to be brilliant. And I'd heard that it was the same guys that did The Triplets of Belleville, which is also called Belleville Rendezvous, that weird French animation about the cyclists.
Sure.
It started up and then immediately within the first 30 seconds... It was doing like a retro animation, but it couldn't decide what decade retro it was doing.
Yeah. But I like that, like, though.
Oh, it really jarred. It really, really jarred. It was a little bit like, okay, are we doing Hanna-Barbera? Are we doing old school Disney?
Rob.
We're just doing a mashup animation stuff.
My dear, sweet baby angel boy. Oh, my... pretty little pristine unicorn egg. Listen, just lean in one sec. Bring your face close
it's
to Papa
Ben's. Arthur's imagination.
No.
But that's not interesting, Ben.
No, because that's not it, Rob. That's a fuck you to James Gunn. That's four.
Four. Three. That's four. Three. That's three.
Oh, that's three?
I edited one, so that's three.
Oh, sound. All right. Three. There's three. It's a middle finger to James Gunn, because James Gunn and obviously the head of DCU left some notes for this film, and Todd Phillips was like, well, it's not a DC movie, it's a Warner Brothers movie, and then opened the film with classic Warner Brothers-esque animation as if to be sort of like, and also there's no DC title card until the credits.
Right, biggest middle finger.
That's the only reason that exists.
Speaking of Warner Brothers and James Gunn, I think Warner Brothers thinks it's quite relevant. We need to talk about the ending. Right?
We need to. Because it's got to be done. I've got a thing on it.
Well, I've got a thing on it as well. And it's
a thing that
makes me dislike Todd Phillips more.
Okay.
When they were making Joker 1, mm-hmm. they were going to have Arthur Fleck on the scene where he paints the smile on the on his face with his broken nose, blood.
Yeah.
Which I think is a brilliant scene.
Yeah.
They weren't going to do that. That was a compromise.
Okay.
What they were actually going to do was have him cut a smile into his face.
Yes.
But at the time, Christopher Nolan was still at Warner Brothers.
He was.
Warner Brothers hadn't lost Nolan.
Yeah.
And so Nolan said, absolutely not, director of The Hangover. Are you taking my character's Chelsea smile?
Yeah.
Like, that's my Joker. Do something of your own. Mm. And it was only when he was told he couldn't do that that Todd Phillips came up with something that I think is arguably better for Arthur Fleck. You know, Arthur Fleck has been punched in the face and he's turned that wound into a strength by painting a smile onto his face with the blood from his broken nose.
Yeah.
But to hear that that wasn't the first idea,
mm-hmm.
it was only what Todd Phillips did when Chris Nolan said no.
Yeah.
And now that Chris Nolan said to Warner Brothers that they can go stuff themselves and Daddy Nolan's not in the Warner Brothers house anymore, does Todd Phillips go, well, I'm doing it anyway. Oh, you can't tell me what to do, Chris Nolan, because you're not at Warner Brothers anymore. And does it with this new guy. And I'm like, that's so childish and petty and not creative.
I love it. That's the best. That's the best. Fuck your neckerchief. All right? Four. Four, it was worth it.
It feels petty. It feels petty. And it feels like the things that I enjoyed about the first one, it turns out weren't great ideas from Todd Phillips. They were compromises made because Daddy Nolan said no. And now that Daddy Nolan's not there anymore, he's like,
oh God, you're just upset that someone's punched Nolan from a distance.
No, I look, the man, he's taken down a peg. I get it. He's just a brilliant director who always delivers engaging.
He's incredible.
He always delivers an engaging film.
Right. Okay. I've got a different takeaway for the ending there, bud. That is fantastic, right, though. It makes me like Todd Phillips a lot more. we're going to spoil it. Another big spoiler warning. The death of Arthur Fleck.
Yes.
Is this the birth of the Joker?
Of the Joker.
Todd Phillips, from even before the first film was released, has maintained that this isn't Joker Prince of Crime from the comic books or previous movies. It is not that Joker.
Right.
He reiterated this recently by saying Joker is not the Joker and this isn't the origin story.
No,
it's just an origin story, right?
Like we said in episode one where I was like, the film's called Joker, it's not called the Joker.
Exactly. So he's then gone on to quote saying that, like, it's this idea that maybe this is the inspiration for the real Joker.
Yes.
Now, Arthur dies at the end of this film. And it's possibly my favorite self-help book that exists.
Right.
Arthur dies in peace. Pure peace.
No, he doesn't.
He's been stabbed with a shiv in the stomach four or five times.
Yeah.
But he dies in peace. And let me tell you for why, right?
Right.
Arthur Fleck is being Arthur Fleck. And what he's doing in that moment is when some young lad comes up to him and is like, hey, do you want to hear a joke? He's not huffing and puffing. He's not like, oh, I've got a visitor, I have to go. He's like, he shows a young, nervous comedian the compassion that he was never shown. He lets him crack a joke. He listens intently and he plays into the bit, right?
Right.
Now, if that isn't true personal growth.
Okay, that's a very good point.
I don't know what is. I have no clue what is.
It's a very, very good point.
He's been beaten up for years, trodden on for years, and he still gives
I can agree with
a
that.
Young kid who's nervous about telling a joke a chance because he was never given that. Oh, beautiful.
Not only will I agree with that, I will, because I've been very heavy on what I didn't like about this film. Yeah. I, like you, left the cinema knowing it was awfully put together, but really enjoying certain aspects of what we did get.
Yeah.
And what you just mentioned there runs completely parallel and totally complements what else I loved about this film.
Okay.
I don't think it's interesting. I don't think Arthur Fleck is interesting.
He's not. He's a very average man.
I don't think he's as interesting as Joker, right? And that's what I feel like we came to see was what's Joker going to do?
Yeah,
because it's a film about Arthur Fleck becoming Joker in Joker 1. Joker 2 is going to be what's Joker doing? And then it turns out that actually Joker's just going to decide he's Arthur Fleck again.
You're such a Harley Quinn right now. I just need you to know that, right?
And that's fundamentally uninteresting to me. However, what I love about the ending of this film is it's not asking you to be a Joker fan and enjoy the film.
Yep.
It's asking you, how much do you care about Arthur Fleck? Because it's all well and good, us watching Joker 1 and going, no one cared and no one this and no one that. Do we care?
No. Look at the box office figures, Rob.
Right.
No one cares.
Exactly. No one cares. So in a way, in a perverse way, the flop of this film has done one thing. Is its biggest success artistically in proving, and I don't care that this is 5, that society doesn't give a fuck about the Arthur Flecks of this world.
Does not.
Because when you got a sequel all about Arthur Fleck, no one turned up, and the people that did hated it.
Exactly. Dude, this is why I like this film, because it turns everything on its head and goes, yeah, it's a flop. Also, not doing that again. Do you want to know why?
Right.
Because what do you want from me?
Right.
What
But
do
it
you
falls
want?
Into the category of a film that make... I could say I've made this film that makes a point about how far we're willing to go to escape ourselves.
Yeah.
And the awful
mind-numbing stuff that we're willing to put ourselves through in the hope of a little bit of escape. And what that film actually is 2 hours of watching paint dry. Now, my point would be correct. Okay. People would come and watch it and they'd get to the 2 hours and go, you see, you sat there for 2 hours and watched paint dry rather than live your life. Aren't I clever? Yes, I would be. But the film would still be objectively bad. And I feel that's what this film is.
I get that. Also, I feel like the film that you just described could also be the synopsis for a circumcision documentary. It's just everyone in this world is after a little bit of freedom.
I agree with you about the ending. I think it's good, and I agree with you about the film. It's an interesting. It's not. It's a worthwhile. It's a fun Arthur Fleck investigation.
Exactly. It's a fun thought experiment. I think it's a great wrap up to a great character study. It's a good follow on of what happens after. A delusional, mentally ill man murders 6 people.
Yes.
And finally owns up to his shit. That's 6. I don't care.
Yeah. To be honest, mate, it's a multiple factors less than we used to do. We were on 6 by the second minute in the show. Yeah.
Most of the intro was just me swearing. It was great. there's no more blame in the world because the world isn't to blame.
Right.
The world didn't see Arthur Fleck because Arthur Fleck didn't exist. Mm-hmm. He was wearing a mask to hide the unhealed trauma, right?
Yeah, he was hiding himself from the world and then going, why does no one see me?
Exactly. And then he had no idea who he was. The world didn't start noticing Arthur Fleck. They noticed Joker.
Yeah.
And after realizing this, Arthur Fleck admits that Joker is a fantasy. That is his mask that he's been presenting to the world. That's what he's being recognized for now. It's a fantasy and he has to accept responsibility for his actions. Yes, he was failed by the systems in place after his social workers' funding was cut. But again, the systems were treating Joker, not Arthur.
Right.
And that to me is mind-bogglingly intense. It's a long 4-hour character study if you watch Joker 1 and 2. And it's a bit fucking weird.
Look, it's a good idea for a film.
I think so too.
If the film that you've just described had been made engaging,
sure,
I would have adored this film.
I get
that. It's not what this film is trying to do. It's how it's trying to do it. It's not well-paced. Okay. It's not focused. It's not audience-facing.
It's not.
It's not engaging. It's not good.
But listen,
mm.
If you're truly working on yourself, and you're looking at all the horrible stuff and you're dealing with your traumas, it's not good. It's not engaging. It's not fun. It's not paced well.
And that's very, very, very clever. Well done, Todd Phillips. Clap, 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 clap. Yes. But I'm not going to watch your film again.
Because this is the thing. When you're in the throes of it and you're watching it play out on a screen, you're like, oh, maybe me doing all of this horribly mundane, boring, nonsensical, mind-numbing, uninteresting stuff just so I can get out of bed in the morning is worthwhile after all, because someone out there deems it worthy of putting $200 million into putting it in front of my eyeballs in my tiny town cinema. That's mind-blowing to me.
But if you want a film, with flights of fantasy, talking about the rehabilitation of an unwell man.
Yeah, definitely.
Watch Bronson with Tom Hardy.
Okay, Bronson's good.
It's the exact same film, but far better.
It's fine. It's fine.
This is Bronson with songs. It's Bronsong.
Bronsong.
Bronsong. But I will make this point in its defense.
Go on.
Everyone talks, we talk about how the box office has become stale, how it's become a bunch of B-minus movies again and again and again, cookie cutter formula.
Yeah.
If you want bold, original cinema, this is what half of it has to look like.
Yes. Yes. Right? Yes, buddy.
You can't want a greater than 50% chance of enjoying a movie.
Yeah, exactly.
And expect something totally unique and new every time. If you want cinema to flourish and you want it to be doing new and unique things, 50% of the time of the cinema, it's going to look like Joker 2.
Exactly. You want speed all the time. What you just want, endless speed. Well, guess what, buddy? 50% of it is going to be speed 2. All right?
Right, exactly.
It has to exist to make speed a better film. Listen, I feel like we've just nailed Joker 2.
I think we have.
I had a great time with it. You didn't enjoy it as much as... I didn't think you'd enjoy it this much, to be honest. I'm surprised we got this far.
It's bollocks, but it's interesting bollocks once.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a far more interesting film to talk about than it is to watch.
Yeah, agreed. Agreed. What are you rating it?
This is a 4.
Okay, that's way more than this I thought you were going to give it.
It's a beautiful looking film.
Mm-hmm.
It's got some merit in the idea. It's got none in the execution.
Okay.
There are some scenes, like the scene with Gary, that I think are really effective.
Oh, heartbreaking.
There are other scenes where, for no reason other than shock value, the prison guards sexually assault Arthur Fleck.
I don't think it's shock value, but that's fine.
I think it's literally just so Todd Phillips can say that prison guards are fucking clowns.
That's absolutely outrageous that you've
that's
just done
that. That's
a
mint joke.
That's fantastic. I legitimately didn't even see it coming, took a moment for it to drop. Well done, sir. Well done, sir. I also think that that's 8. You know what I mean? Fuck it. Okay. Make it 9.
Speaking of numbers, what are you rating it?
I'm going to give this... you're not going to be happy about this. I thoroughly enjoyed this film. I thought it was punishing to watch. I thought it was mundane. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. I think it was important. I think it was an important exercise, and it was a very reaffirming moment for me to see someone struggling with their mental health, but it be important enough to be a mm-hmm. focal point. I truly... truly enjoyed it. I'm going to give it a 7.
Wow, this is like the rule 34 of cinema for you, huh?
Dude, you're like the fourth person that said this to me. Like,
right?
Like
someone out there's going to enjoy it.
Yeah, that's it, man. Someone's going to enjoy it. I genuinely had a good time with it. I know no one else is enjoying it, and that's fine.
Genuinely, mate, I would drop Todd Phillips a message so he knows that it wasn't a complete waste of time, because you might be the only one.
Nah, he listens to the show. It's fine. Do you know how much this made in its first week?
Oh, God.
121 million worldwide.
Okay. What's hilarious about that is that mm-hmm. everybody who was watching it out of curiosity. So that's as much as it will ever make.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see. It's the last Joker film in this universe anyway. So that's
oh, really?
Fine. Yeah.
I would have sworn that Warner Brothers are going to be like, guys, you have to.
We've
got another 500 mil that we need to write off the tax. Please. Let's...
have we got a comment corner?
We do, but we don't have any time.
Oh, okay.
So what we're going to do, we've got an episode planned in a couple of weeks where it's a big one. It's some big news.
It is a big one.
Some big news. Not necessarily pleasant news, but we'll see. We've got Panic Room, and then we'll do a big bumper comment corner on that week.
Okay.
After Panic
Room. That sounds
great. All right?
Well,
all right, bud.
If that's the case, then I guess we are fully out of time. Guys, thank you so much for hanging out with us. It has been an absolute pleasure. We love and appreciate each and every one of you.
We really
wholeheartedly
do.
Thank you for spending your time with us.
Ben is now going to thank you for spending an hour of your week with us, especially at the start of the week. It means a lot, you know. So he's going to wrap up the thoughts, themes, and feelings of this movie into a little Monday motivation pep talk while I just tell you to do what society always tells you to do, which is... consume.
I'm just going to lean into it, man. It's not fun. It's not paced well. It's not an entertaining experience, but doing slogging through the self-help work, you know, looking inwards, doing all that stuff, gets you a 4 out of 10. So fuck it. You know what I mean? Be speed. Be Keanu on a bus, I think is the point of the film. I think that's the takeaway from today, buddy. I think that's where we're at.